Hello friends, and after a glorious and motivating lecture by Mr. Nayan Kotian, I'm sure he's woken us all up. The presentation that followed about the foot clinic took me back to my engineering days where we studied a lot of that in one of our subjects, and it was just a reflection back into those lectures and those books. Very quickly to connect back to that presentation is many people ask me that you are an engineer and now an adventurer, what sense does it make? But very few people realize that all that you have learned is not lost. And adventure is one place, no matter you are from commerce, you're from arts, you're from science, you're from any background, the people that you deal with will essentially come from these backgrounds, and all your knowledge has to come back to assist them and form better bondages. Also, all this knowledge leads to a better awareness of your environment. I would like to, before I call upon the esteemed guests here, I would like to just reflect back on the day's happenings, and I'm very also lucky that they have left some trails that lead into this session, which is safety. Mr. Harish Kapadia, earlier he made a few mention about the mention of shift from the higher peaks to the technically difficult peaks. He also made a mention of us as adventurers taking calculated risks. He also made a mention, which is a good thing for all us in the industry, about commercial expeditions climbing safely. What does all this mean? It just means that safety is the core of our business. Later, Mr. Akshay Kumar, who is an industry veteran and has a lot of experience at the national level, he made a mention about the competition barriers coming down. Because of the competition barriers coming down, obviously there is a price war. Price war means compromising on safety. Mr. Krishna Kumar, he mentioned trust drives transaction. It all falls into place where our clients, or not only our clients, but our friends, trust us to tread them on a safer path. Besides this, in our forums, I'm representing Atom here. So in our forums, I once walked into the office and I said, adventure is free. Wait, hang a minute. We are not offering any free adventure, so don't run up to us for some free coupons or anything of that sort. But it's the safety that costs. Right? When we look at safety, I'll explain you this in a very simple manner. Go to the edge of a mountain. You want to experience the free fall, but it's the safe landing that will cost you money. It'll cost you a rope. It'll cost you a parachute. It'll cost you a paraglider. The higher the adrenaline, the greater the investment in your safety, okay? And this investment in safety actually follows into three different zones of adventure. The first zone is before you step out into the outdoors and participate in any adventure. That is where planning comes into picture. I have always believed that safety is not something that you have to learn and practice. Safety has to be ingrained in yourself. Safety means that you have to be aware of your environment, your actions, and each and everything that you do around your business, your activity, and your people. The next one, obviously, is in today's world, which is fast advancing, very difficult to keep pace with what's happening around in the world. And we all like to talk about our equipment, our mobile phones, our gear, but adventure is one place where everyone wants to talk about your gear. Everyone wants to handle a carabiner, everyone wants to handle a figure of eight, the latest of the Grigri devices, and the best of the ropes and everything. Equipment and gear is one of the most important threads. But we have the planning, we have the equipment, do we have the training? This is how we've divided our session. I'm going to invite first Mr. Divyesh Muni, because he is going to be talking about the planning aspect of adventure. Just to give you a brief introduction on about Mr. Divyesh Muni, of course many people know him and he doesn't need much of an introduction, but I'll keep it short. Again, like I said, you know, there are people out here in the forum who are professionals, there are people out here in the forum, and I would say there are celebrated people out here in the forum who are not professionals but do it out of their own passion. Amongst one of them is Mr. Divyesh Muni, who is a chartered accountant by profession. He has been on various Himalayan expeditions. He has led a lot of joint expeditions along with foreign teams. He has a lot of first ascents to his name. I am not taking the names of those first ascents because that's quite well known, but some of the best first ascents are a new route to Chongkungdam, first ascents of Rangrek, ascents of Kagbushan, Kamet, Manirang. He's one of those people who likes to explore newer areas and walk into uncharted terrain. Other than that, he's a long distance runner. He's conducted a lot of adventure camps, so he definitely knows about what you need to take care of on the safety front. All adventurers are photographers, yeah, but then there are special photographers. He's one amongst them, having had some exhibitions to that effect. He's been an avid member. I've been knowing him since I joined Himalayan Club, and he's an avid member of the Himalayan Club. Other than that, he's also been celebrated and honored by a lot of awards, most noted among them being Excellence in Mountaineering by the Indian Mountaineering Foundation in 2014. Without eating into much of his time, I would like to invite him and give us some insight about the planning aspect and safety.
Well, friends, I really like this little cartoon which I downloaded from the net. And the quizzical look on the face signifies what space most of us are in with regard to safety. I was asked to speak on safety, and I was asked to select my own topic. And I'm very passionate about systems, so I decided to talk on a systemic approach to safety in adventure. We are a little short of time, so I'm not going to go into much details. But the very first thing is for us to accept that yes, in our activity there is a risk involved. And if there is a risk involved, how is it going to affect us? All of us here are here to make money from adventure, I'm assuming, because it is the forum today. And therefore, if you are looking at compromising safety, what is the risk that you are taking? This is a picture Rajesh told me that it was also shared in the morning by Mr. Kapadia. I arrived a little late. But basically, it goes back to 1865, the first ascent of Matterhorn. And after the ascent took place, four of the climbers, while returning down, climbing down, they died. Now, an accident is an accident. We are nobody to go back and see as to what happened, what was right, what was wrong. But what was the result of that? There was a lot of debate. Despite this being such a celebrated event, there was a lot of debate. And the activity of mountaineering nearly got banned by the Queen. So this is the risk that we are taking. In the various years of my experience, I've come across so many such incidences. The most recent, in fact, the next session is going to be about the government GR that we are all facing. Has anybody understood the basis? How did that GR come into place? It started from an accident. It started from a death of an individual, of a child who had gone for a camp in Manali and died of altitude sickness. I have myself witnessed an instructor on a rock climbing course who was climbing way beyond his own ability, takes a fall in front of all the students, and we had to rescue the instructor. He just was fortunate to be alive. An instructor who was with one of the noted bank on a rock climbing training course, was standing unanchored halfway up a slab, and when a student took a slip, he knocked the instructor off, and the instructor was taken to hospital. We've all come across so many incidences of accidents during the OMD programs that are happening. And as I understand it, and I have been observing this industry because I deal with the industry myself as a chartered accountant, and I speak to companies who are or used to have these courses run, and they no longer liked having their executive go to courses where they return back with injured knees, and they've had falls, and I hear that some of them have been pretty serious injuries. 2 weeks ago, I was in Panchgini, and I was with a close friend, and I asked him what's happening with the parasailing activity here, and they said, we've banned this activity in Panchgini because there are too many accidents. This is what I mean, friends, that if we are not able to take care of safety, we are going to be the ultimate losers. And how are we going to take care of safety? Is it a one incident here and you learn something from it, and then next day morning you get up in the morning, you think about it, okay, what can I do about it? Okay, I'm going to change my organization in this manner. No, it has to be a holistic approach. Wikipedia defines systemic as something that is spread throughout, system-wide. Safety has to be ingrained in the entire organization. It has to become a culture within your organization. It has to become a habit in your organization. So I'm just going to briefly take you through some of the points here. This topic is something that you could have a workshop on for several days and then actually implement it. Be that is, I will compare and take you through a very so-called risky industry. The airline industry, most people are believing that it's a very risky industry. But is it factually so? Here you have nearly 200 metric tons of weight flying several thousand feet above the air. And how many flights take off every day from across the world? If you actually go to statistics, it has been proved that flying is safer than traveling by rail or by road. Difficult to believe, but that is the case. And how does that industry make it happen? Most of you are familiar with this sight when you take a flight. And I assure you, most of you get pretty bored at looking at this thing and you say, oh, not again. But if I asked you today, what happens if the air pressure drops in the aircraft? I'm 100% sure that you all will tell me the right answer. If I ask you where are the exit points in the aircraft, I'm 100% sure you'll tell me. Because this particular exercise has been regimented as part of the flying, and you may be flying 3 times a day, and all 3 times you'll witness it. This is just a small example of how this industry has put safety as part of the system. This is a sort of a checklist of an aircraft or of a flight. They are looking at all 3 aspects. Pilot, who's going to actually take your aircraft safely, the aircraft itself, and the environment. And various points have been listed out which the industry feels may affect the safety of the person. For example, what is the physical condition of the pilot? Has he had enough sleep? What about the food and water? Has he had any alcohol? In such detail, the checklists are prepared and followed that safety has become part of their systems. And that is what we need to do in our organizations. The foundation of all activity is planning. And therefore, in order to get safety within your organization, you need to first identify the risks involved. Now, every adventure activity has a different kind of risk involved. Have you all ever sat down and listed down that, okay, if I'm an agency who takes treks, what are the risks that are being faced by my organization, by my clients? A few examples I'll give you. If you're taking a children's camp, have you ever thought of it that is the child that is attending the camp allergic to smoke? Well, if you're going to have a campfire, or if you're going to give the child an occasion to cook on their own on a wood fire. I've seen an incident where the child went into an asthma attack because she was allergic to smoke. Now, this is a risk you need to deal with, because if you're very far from any medical facility, it could be a fatality with you. Many of you have been on monsoon treks. One of the most common risks faced by us is cloudbursts. There are people who take high altitude treks, there are people who take tours to Kailash Mansarovar or be to Leh. How many of you have had incidences where clients come in with high blood pressure or with cardiac conditions, and then you are faced with a difficult situation? Or a very simple thing, you are transporting your clients from one location to the other. If you're going down at a high speed and the vehicle carrying them has a tire burst, what is the risk involved? Have you identified these? If you've identified this, there is a solution, or there's a way of dealing with these risks involved. So the first thing is to avoid the cause itself. If you have customers with cardiac condition, you don't take them for your high altitude trek. You can expose them to a different adventure. Or if you have a child who's allergic, you don't expose the child to smoke. The second is to mitigate. You reduce the probability or impact of it. Now, a vehicle breakdown is possible, but have you ensured that the vehicle that you're hiring, the source from which you're hiring, is giving you assurance of the quality and condition of the vehicle? The third thing is, having reduced it, you may still face it, because risk, accidents, etc. do happen. And your organization is at the biggest risk if there's an accident. So how are you going to transfer the risk faced by you onto another agency? The way of doing it is insurance. Now, I know this is a sticky issue with a lot of us, because insurance in India doesn't cater to adventure industries as well as it should. But yes, if as an industry we try and get this done at a government level, this is very important. The last is contingency plans, and that's where we come into the areas of search and rescue, we come into the areas of first aid, etc. Have you got a plan in place? The next aspect of it is equipment. I'm not going to go into equipment, because the next speaker, Bhushan, is an expert on equipment, and he will take us through this topic. We are looking now at facilities. You've organized for your group to stay at a particular location. Have you really considered all aspects of the facility that you're offering, whether it may be the quality of water that you're giving, the hygiene facilities, etc.? These minor things need to be looked into at a planning stage to ensure that you have a very safe and good experience to your customers. One of the most important aspects of any business, and especially our business, is human resources. The trainers, facilitators, volunteers. I use volunteers because I'm also dealing with non-profit organizations, but you have paid staff. Are they qualified for these specific activities? Can you send a person who's done an advanced mountaineering course to lead a diving trip? No, you can't. You have to be very specific as to what is the nature of activity and have a specific training for the person. Having had the qualification, what is the knowledge level, what is the experience that person has? We saw a trend happening in Maharashtra, at least, where somebody who's done a couple of hikes suddenly becomes a volunteer or a leader of a trip in which they are dealing with novices. Now, the person is not able to handle himself or herself, and he's trying to take care of others. You need to have a certain level of knowledge and experience of that activity in order to further take care of others. I want to take an example of what happens in Europe or US, the Western countries. If you are to guide any novice, you need to be qualified and you need to have a certificate as a guide. And you don't get it very easily. You need to be of a certain level of experience and skill. You need to have done, say for example, if you are a guide taking a climb, you need to have a certain basic level of climbing skills. You should have done that particular grade of climb. And not only it's just not a one-time experience qualification, but every year you are supposed to log in that many number of climbs on your own in order to continue that certification and in order to continue handling other people's lives. And if despite all these things in place, if you don't follow, then you are liable for criminal action. So this is what we should see that our industry here also implements. You need to have skill levels. I gave an example of an instructor who was climbing way beyond his own skill level on a training course. So you can't have that kind of a thing happen. That person should be having skills enough to deal not only himself but also of the customer, the clients. I'm not getting into training. Fitness is very important in order to take part in any adventure activity. Is your staff qualified to deal with emergencies? Do they have the knowledge of first aid? Do they have sufficient decision-taking capacity? Now here, you need to simulate exercises among your staff to see to it how they react. Because apart from training and knowledge, it's people's psychological build-up as to how they react to a certain situation. I've been involved in an accident and I had this first-class scout who was on my rope. And the moment he saw blood, he forgot all his knots. You know, it's just psychological. The person could not take the emergency. Do your staff have the necessary PR skills? And are they able to deal with your clients sufficiently well in order to deal with any eventuality that may take place? The next aspect, which is very important, is communication. Here I'd like to share with you what I've understood seeing what is happening in the armed forces. They have what they call as a situation report, or SITRAP, in which there is a very structured form of communication happening. There is a very structured form of reporting that takes place at all levels. I'll give you a very interesting example. A couple of months ago, there was an accident on Chanderi. And I knew of a group that had organized a trek on the next day. So I called up the person whom I knew in that organization and I said, there's a group going. Are you aware that there's been an accident? He said, oh no, I didn't know about it. So I said, why don't you inform them? So he's saying, but I don't know whom to inform. I said, why don't you inform the leader of the trek? He said, I don't know who's the leader of the trek. Now here you have a person who is in a managerial position. He doesn't know where his group is going. He doesn't know who's the group leader. He doesn't know how many people are going. So this is what I mean by communication channels. You need to have people communicate in a proper structured manner so that the right information goes to the right place. Technology is very important. We talked about, of course, walkie-talkies are not that much of a problem. Sat phones are now being sorted out. Mobiles, messaging devices. We need to get familiar with these kind of technology so that you are able to deal with any situation. And of course, having all that with you, you also need to be trained enough to deal with it. The participants are very important here. Do they have the knowledge level required from that adventure activity? I did a diving course some time ago, and it was very interesting. After having done the course, they give you a certificate of diving. And based on the skill level that you've attained, they give you a certificate to say, okay, he's a scuba diver, or he's an open sea diver, or he's a professional diver. So that anywhere in the world you take that card, and you say, I want to do a dive, they will first know that this gentleman has this level of skill and therefore they will deal with you accordingly. This is what is very important. You don't take a novice for a rock climb where he is way above his capacity. The second part of it is information. Knowledge is one, information of what they are getting into. When you have a course for children, do the parents know that these children are not going for a walk in the park? They are going for adventure, and that their children are going to be exposed to risks. Do they have the knowledge when the program is going to start? When is it going to end? What do they do if they have to, if there's an emergency? What do they do if they have to communicate something? This kind of knowledge is necessary to be passed on to the participants. And the third thing is fitness. As I mentioned, there are people who go for high altitude treks who are having asthma or having cardiac condition, and the organizers are not even aware about these conditions. So you need to have a system in place where you test the level of fitness of the particular participant so that you are not in for surprises. You can't take a person for a Kailash tour, reach 2 days into the trip, and then suddenly realize that this person has got a high blood pressure and he's not able to take the altitude. You should have done your homework much before. Actual activity execution. How many of you have a time schedule which is maintained? If you don't maintain a time schedule, you could be in a lot of trouble. 2 months ago, we did a simple trek, Rajesh and myself and some of our friends, we went for a Sahyadri trek. We were on the way down, it was pretty late in the afternoon, and we were in good time, and then there was a group that was coming up, a group of nearly 30 novices led by two leaders, and they were still struggling to go up. They were terribly lost, and we got them out of the situation, and they still wanted to go up. I said, have you seen the time? It's, if you try and go to the top now, you are never going to be coming back before sunset, and then you don't have torches with you. So this kind of scheduling is important, and it's important to keep track of the timing that's happening. There's a very interesting exercise done in the airline industry itself, and a friend of mine who was in charge of giving lectures on safety talked about this flagging system. That means as you go through the day with your activity, you flag certain events based on their importance. For example, you're walking out with your group in the morning and the weather is cloudy. Okay, it's not a very serious thing. Maybe you'll keep it as a yellow flag. As you go on, somebody sprains a leg. Now that's a serious issue, and later on that could cause a problem. So you put a red flag to that particular incident. As you go through the day, if you come to a situation where there are too many red flags, you need to decide to turn back and don't go to a situation where it leads to a crisis. So this flagging system is very interesting. If you document it well and if you follow it well, you will avoid problems. The next is the participant to trainers ratio. I really don't need to say much about it. As I said, we saw 30 participants and two leaders, and they couldn't take care of everybody. You know, they were, the whole group was scattered all over the place. So you can't have those kind of ratios. However qualified, trained, etc. your leaders may be, if the ratio is wrong, they're not going to be able to handle the situation. If you do have an accident, and please expect it, the best of people in the industry have had accidents despite all the care taken. But you need to deal with it. Do you have a disaster management protocol in place? Do you have a document which says that if this thing happens, this is what is going to be done by the organization? Do you have search and rescue in place? This is something which we need to actually deal with separately, and that is search and rescue. In Maharashtra, we unfortunately don't have a structured search and rescue system. And I hope that someday we all get together and form some kind of a structured system. Maybe this could be a discussion for another day. Does your organization have adequate material and training for first aid? And third, last but not the least, is are you all properly insured? Post-accident care is also necessary. Customer care, very necessary. You can't neglect a person who's gone through an accident. And here, soft gloves need to be taken because people don't understand what has gone wrong many times, and you have to be very careful dealing with people who are injured. You need to have a debrief at the end of an accident and try and understand, learn the lessons. Review is required in every organization. You have to upgrade equipment, people, processes in order to ensure that you are up to date in what's happening around you. So, having said this, how do you make safety as part of the system? The most important part is document it, whatever you've planned, whatever you've decided, whatever safety measures you're going to put in place. You create standard operating procedures, you create checklists, and last but not the least, you have a thorough regimentation of whatever you have decided to do. It has to happen regardless of circumstances. You must follow those procedures. Thank you very much.